Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance being led by Marie AC.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can you hear me okay? Is that...
We can, but I got to do one thing before I get to you, real quick. And first, welcome everybody to the first official meeting, or regular meeting, I guess we call it, of the month of October 2024, the Village of Ballston Spot Board of Trustees. This was originally scheduled for the 15th. However, due to the Zoning Advisory Committee's presentation and group discussion, which I'm sure we'll hear more about later on tonight, that will be on the 15th at 7 o'clock. We will be having a meeting on the 15th at 6:30 in Village Hall just to take care of some housekeeping with respect to the BOA steering committee and a couple other minor things as they come up as well. And we'll put out an agenda for that as well. Can I get a motion that the minutes of the September 23rd, 2024 meeting be approved?
I'll make the motion.
I'm going to give it to and I will give Trustee Bernadette Fondanza the second on that. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Now it's time. So as you might have heard and look around you, because yeah, you can see it for sure, it's looking a little different here right now. The library is about to go through some dramatic changes, and we will be kicked out temporarily for our meetings, but they're saying that they're welcome us back at some point, hopefully early next year. Lori Acey on the library board is here to tell us about what's going on and maybe talk about some of the motions that are on for later tonight.
Yes, thank you so much. Welcome, everybody. We really appreciate the invitation to come and catch you up at the library. Mayor Rossi had, you know, reached out and wanted us to come by to talk about the renovation, the expansion, our progress, and just what's happening presently. So this is a real honor for us to be with you all. Our phrase for our campaign is funding our future, and brick by brick and book by book. And that actual little slogan, brick by brick and book by book, was written by one of the library clerks, which is kind of nice, Kristen. She's also worked on our grants committee with us, so she's been a huge help. Next slide. It's going to change the slide out because it's a winter scene.
It should be. Yeah.
We don't really want to see winter before we have to, but that's just an exterior photo of the architect of the building. We can go to the next slide. So our capital campaign is, in theory or in essence, it's all about the library, obviously, and raising funds independently with the Friends of the Library group. Because as you all know, the library is the most visited public center in the Village of Ballston Spa. And we have an in-need community that we serve, and it certainly plays a vital role. We're committed to developing and updating this building. It's very cherished by everyone in the village, and we need it to be up to date to 21st century needs. So in May of 2022, we successfully completed a master plan proposal with Paul Mays of Holland Butler Mays Architects, who are located here in Ballston Spa, and our library director, our board of trustee group, our friends officers are all dedicated to the improvements of this building, as outlined in this plan. And something that always hits me very heavily, which I don't know that everybody is aware of, is that our library has not seen a significant update since the 1970s. So if you do the math on that, it's, you know, over 50 years. And so that's a significant amount of time for the most, you know, the public building in the village to, you know, to not be able to have been renovated. So we, as a group, we're so proud and happy that we can now initiate these renovations from a lot of these fundraising efforts. The master plan will allow us effectively to provide comprehensive access to library collections, spaces, and programming to the entire community served by the library, raise and fully develop the critical need areas of the building that's deteriorating in several areas. So our objectives, and these are based on many things that you'll see up and coming in the slides, but it's to complete the master plan, obviously in phases, with our goals of improving the efficiency and sustainability of the building systems, minimizing our operating costs, addressing safety and accessibility issues, increasing non-collection program spaces and flexibility for children, young adults, and adult populations, to improve the recognition of our local history and art and access to the same, acknowledging the importance of the teen population with an appropriate space, expanding children's collection and program spaces and resources, improving staff efficiency in the pursuit of patron services, and increasing our patrons' access to technology. So if you look at the key contributors, we basically just tried to outline them all because there's so many people that have been involved in this project. And we really feel strongly that we do this work with a ton of support. And obviously we're looking at all of you as our support. The community has been amazing. This all has come to fruition on the backs of many shoulders, not just one. So we're really proud of that, especially. And we listed everybody so that everyone can tell who has really been integral in the structure of the work on the capital campaign. Obviously, we want to extend a special thank you to Mayor Rossi because he's been working with us all along on budgets, guidance, questions, various pieces of advice. He's always, you know, he's been very supportive, and including currently recently in the bidding phase. So there's always been a bridge for us. We've always had a good relationship with our library liaison and, of course, the friends and all the board trustees and our member friends, our grant group, the village, and everybody. So thank you all. So we'll take a little quick look at the timeline because it kind of shocked me when I was looking at the various things that we've done over the past 3 years that we've actually been working on this for 3 years from, like, you know, infancy to now, but the actual fundraising has probably been a year and a half to 2 years. So in the winter of 2021, we began to think about this building and how it really needed attention. And so we started to research, you know, other libraries that are similar to us, like Galloway, Schuylerville, Stillwater, and libraries such as that in kind of on a smaller scale. And, you know, a lot of them were under construction, or even Saratoga Library or Clifton Park had, you know, a lot of construction funds coming in. We thought, where are they going to get money, and who are their architects? And so we started to dig around in that way. And so amazingly, which I always think this is kind of a little bit of a gift, we found Paul Mays at Butler and Mays right here in our village, which is kind of amazing. I think it's almost like a little synchronicity, but he, Paul himself and that architectural firm is one of the largest library architectural firms in the country. And they've done work from the East Coast to the West Coast, but also on this coast. So Paul himself, he's kind of our direct contact architect, and he's not only is he an exceptional architect, and if you ever are curious about their work, you can jump on the website and look at all the libraries that they've worked on, and they're really, really beautiful. But he's also an exceptional person. So we've had the good luck of working with him and going to the library, evaluating the space, doing an inventory, assessing different things with a workshop with the public, reviewing the existing building, the property, the services. You know, Paul met with us obviously many, many times to come up with goals for the current life, you know, for the library and current trends. In the summer of 2021, we conducted a community input survey, and we had quite a bit of help with the technical end of that from Dave Ulmer from the Ballston Spot Professional Organization. That was a survey for our long-term plan, but it also really informed the library renovation project because the community was able to really give us some very specific feedback. So in the spring of 2022, we had the community survey data, and then we had an interactive session with the public with Paul Mays. He came and we just asked a lot of questions about what mattered to them and what they used and what they felt was most critical. So right around that time, the Friends of the Library began their focused efforts to assist us in thinking about our fundraising efforts, because we knew once we finished that charrette and the interactive public feedback that we would have to start to that ball rolling about how we were actually going to come up with funds to make this happen. So in December of that year, around 2022, we had a capital campaign kickoff and invited the community and had a little party here, and a lot of people came and spoke, and the school district representatives came, and all the, you know, village trustees were here. It was a lovely moment to kick off this new adventure that we're on. We also sent out an annual appeal letter that year to the community, and we had quite a few press releases at that time, yeah, just to inform the public about the construction and the needs of the library. In summer of 2022, we established a little small grants group and a research group, you know, for wording content and attracting grant foundation money. So that group became very active then. So this graphic slide is really public input. It's public input from the workshop, and it's just a pictorial to show you where things landed out. So if you look at the prioritizations of the data points, you know, things like the children's space was the number one thing, the children's collection, that was an area that was probably the favorite and most important thing. A quiet reading, or they call it quiet or noisy reading room, so that will be part of this addition on the upper level. That was important. This room, the, you know, the local community room, different things like the Soho conference room, which is basically like a little conference room you could book on the upper level, computers and tech, local history. Yeah, this is considered like a large event meeting room. Adult collection. There's so many things. The teen space was big. And so this is all very good input. And we felt very good about the public being represented and what they wanted to see in the building. So the next slide is our timeline. And in the fall of 2022, we submitted our first foundation application or grant application to the Alfred Solomon Trust. And we asked kind of big, and we thought, well, we always say this, let's ask for big, and they could always come back smaller, right? So we did. And so amazingly, and you know, we really did not know what to expect, because for a lot of us, this was the first time that we had actually worked on a lot of grants, but we did have some really key people like Kathy Gibson, one of the village residents who does a lot of grant work for her living. But we felt really happy that we didn't have to pay someone to help work on grants with us, that we all just kind of put our heads together and figured out what the foundations were looking for and just got the data together and worked as a group with the friends to make that happen. So in December of 2022, we were awarded our first grant for $100,000 from the Solomon Foundation. We also met with our friends, some of our friends, colleagues, with local politicians like Mary Beth Walsh, Jim Tedisco, Gary Warner, and some others, Paul Tonico. And in the spring of 2023, Mary Beth Walsh secured for us a $40,000 FOLA aid grant for the building in general, just for this project. We held a lot of community events, auctions, and social mixer night, trivia night, author night. Dan Bergman came and played at the Brookside for us. We tried to do a balance of community fund, you know, programming to kind of engage the community and have an enjoyable time together as a community, and then raise awareness with the library. But also, some were obviously raised more money, like our auction raised over almost $12,000. So that was very exciting. The Way We Work Car Show, we tried to have a place, you know, a presence there, family fun day, farmers market, movie nights in the park, just so that we're connecting with the community. So with the guidance of Paul and his firm, and also Southern Adirondack Library System, so our library is under Southern Adirondack Library Systems, and there's others throughout the state, and Paul Mays obviously is our architect, has done a lot of application work to apply to the Department of Library Development for funds, and so he was a huge mentor for us and guide to do that, to pull that process out. So we did the application with his guidance, submitted to the New York State Department of Library Development in the spring of 2023. And at that time, SALS, Southern Adirondack Library Systems, recommended that we ask for 65% of phase 1A. So originally, we kind of wondered if it might, in some cases, it could be 25-75. That's what we were really hoping for originally. But they, at that point in time, they said, our sense on all the libraries that want funding, this is probably a good place to a middle mark to hit. So we did. In the end, which was really rewarding, is that we did get the 25-75. And that happened as a result of another library, we believe at the last minute, may not have fulfilled the requirements, they might not have had all their paperwork in. Something happened where the library was pulled out of the process, essentially, and so we were actually awarded more funding. So that was like a very nice surprise. So if you go to the timeline, this little blip, by the fall of 2024, for our Friends of the Library team efforts and grant work, we raised approximately $272,000 from private donations in the community, so just individuals, community members, you know, general business owners from our local community, and foundation grants. The majority was coming from foundations and grants. And then also we received that $40,000 in bullet aid from Assemblywoman Mary Beth Walsh. So the total up at this point is around $312,000. So we feel really proud of that because we had no idea really how successful we would be. We just knew that we all were committed to it and that we all wanted to work with each other and see what we could accomplish. On October, just recently, a week ago or so, October 1st of 2024, we were awarded that Department of Library Development monies of $502,474 from that original application that we submitted for state aid, library construction program. And that particular pot of money goes to phase 1A. So to say that it's been an amazing experience would be to really lay it low, because we just were really honestly blown away. Like the Lions Club came in, the Ballston Spa National Bank, Stewart's, and Atlantic Trust. There's so many community members. We did approach them, and we actively approached them, but they all really came in and wanted to support this project. So the next couple of slides, and we'll go fairly quickly through them, just kind of show you how this will progress and what phases there are. So this is the existing floor plan, which everybody is probably pretty familiar with. We can go to the next slide. And this is the phase 1A that we're working on now. So the two big pieces are just the local history room and the reading room, which they'll be one on top of the other right behind you. So that will happen very soon, the groundbreaking. If you go to the next slide, it's a rendering of what that will look like from the outside. So there'll be an entry to go in there. The upper level is the reading room. The lower level is the local history room. There was some talk, possibly not during this phase, at some point maybe having a small patio there with Adirondack chairs so people could sit and have coffee and read books and walk back and forth in the village, which would be really great. And then if you go to the next slide, this is the conceptual master plan at full build out. So I did not bring phase 1B, and I did not bring 2 and 3, because you can get the sense that this is where there's some phases, because it's actually kind of, it's a lot. Each phase is like an individual project. But at full build out, it's phase 1A, which is this bump out for the local history room and reading room. And then phase 1B, forgive me, is this lobby area. So if you come into the library from the parking lot, you come in a door, it's a very narrow turn, you go up a tiny staircase or into this room. So the architect felt that this really needed to have like a designated lobby so that when, especially for people who are handicapped, because there's no room to turn around when you come in there. And then if you need the elevator, you're going through a whole other entry too. And it's, there's, you know, like a lift there. So it's not great for accessibility. So eventually phase 1B, which is next, will be the lobby. The stairway is widened significantly. He kind of kidded when he looked at the stairway that it felt like going up into like your grandma's attic, like very narrow. And if you were handicapped, you know, you could not really, it's very tight. So that is that. And then when you get up to the top of that, there will be a little bit of a wider landing. So that's also for fire safety. And just if you're, you know, in a wheelchair or something, you'll have a little space to rest and move around. So that is that. And then phase 2, let's go to that. And I don't know that slide. I think it's just those are cases. But so phase 2 is essentially the upper level of the library. Actually, I'm sorry, Jen, can we go back one? Mm-hmm. So phase 2 is this big area where it's kind of the central part of us. And so you'll see there's a nonfiction area, the area for computers, it's kind of moved into the back corner. The staff right now and the library director are working in this tiny cubicle where, you know, when you come to check out a book, you're going up to the counter, you have a staff there, but they have no workspace to spread out to work in crafts or work, you know, participating in programming. The library director is literally right behind them in her office. You know, you can almost not turn around in it. So the architect suggested that she have a dedicated space. This is a small meeting room. This is the reading room that comes from phase 1A. But this is all phase 2. Computers go over here, fiction section, children's area, teen area. It's could reconfigure quite a bit. So this whole area here is dedicated to the children's collection. And he suggested almost like a frosted or transparent wall. So you could see in there, but the kids, you know, have it to themselves, but there's a lot of transparency. So that's really very exciting. And then phase 3 is this lower level here, the meeting room, and then the storage, and then a dedicated staff area, because they literally have no place right now to eat their dinner, their lunch. If they're working, they eat in the middle of stacks and a little table on the side. So they've never really had like a place they can go and take a break and have a meal. So we felt like that was important, and that would eat up a lot of that side storage area. So that's a really quick overview of the plans. And I had a few photographs that I thought you might enjoy that were from other libraries that Paul had shown us. This is Schuylerville, and this is their reading room. It doesn't mean that ours will be exactly like that, but this will be the second story here that's going to be in the bump out. And it's a room that can be moved around. You can, in some cases, you won't even be able to separate it. Like if you wanted to, there's doors, the newspapers along the side. People can reserve it. If you want to have a smaller meeting than a meeting like in this space, you can go into that space. The furniture is movable. We're hopeful that we could have some kind of technology in there. So there'd be like maybe a TV. So if you needed to hook up a PowerPoint, go to the next slide. This is Goshen. Now, you know, some of the libraries have a different flair. So this isn't necessarily saying that we would go with this style, but they try to make use a lot of the natural light, the window nooks, things that are comfortable for kids that can climb up so parents can sit with them and be with them. Especially in the front of the library, we have a lot of, this way I'm orienting myself, but there's a lot of windows, but there's like a lot of stuff around, so you're not really enjoying them by sitting in the furniture area. So he suggested like what he calls like little niches or niches. So we can go to Kinderhook. This is the teen space in the Kinderhook library. It's also a dedicated space. I mean, everybody has a sense now that teens really need a place to connect, and it's very common in like Saratoga Public Library, Clifton Park Public Library. So we really felt like they're kind of blended in with the children's space. They don't really have a dedicated area to get together after school or maybe work on projects. So this is not exactly what ours would look like, but it's just an example of a possible solution. Next is Brewster. And this kind of reminded me a lot of the front of our library. So Paul had suggested, you know, really to make more use of these spaces so that people can be in little discrete areas and read and study or use the resources of the library, because the space isn't really utilized fully. It's almost like there's little tables in the middle, and then there's exterior spaces that are just there. This one is Saugerties, and this is just a sample of like a little reading area. So you could certainly put the furniture kind of in a circle near the front windows, and people could have meetings there if they listen to a lab, or they could just hang out with other people. But it's a nice way also to look out onto the street. And then he just gave that one example. And the last example, it's kind of simple, but if you see where our computer stations are now in the library, it's a really tough, you know, situation. It's there on top of kind of you know, some very old furniture. The chairs are not in great condition, they're very old. So he suggested possibly more of this type of thing, a little privacy, and it's set up more like a little tables that go next to each other in an outer corner of the library. So that is all I have for everybody, but I just wanted to kind of tell you or give you an example of sense, I guess, for where we started, how far we've come, what the architect has done to guide us. He's been phenomenal, and how appreciative we are of all of you and everything that you've done for us. And that is all I have.
Thanks, Lori.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. And Christine Fitzpatrick from Friends is going to say a couple of words from our fundraising group. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Lori. That was a great job with an overview, and it's very, very exciting. Just a couple of things about the relationship, so that we understand it, between the you know, Ballston Spot Public Library and Friends of the Library, which is very, you know, I think important for people to understand. The Friends is a not-for-profit 501c3. It was organized in 1998 and got its not-for-profit status, 501c3 status, and also incorporation in the state of New York in 2000-2001. It is, the Friends is a group, it's a membership organization, as I said, a 501c3. It has a board of directors, as opposed, because it's a not-for-profit, as opposed to a board of trustees, which is what a public entity would likely have. And it is, it is organized, the whole purpose of the Friends is to support the library in terms of programming and anything else that the library may need. The situation is that there are certain things that, for example, this Division of Library Development Grant is state money, it can only be given to a municipality. So the Village of Ballston spot runs the library. It's a public library. There are other types of libraries. This is a public library. So the state, and rightly so, can only, if they're going to give money to the public library, they have to give it to the municipality. It is not the case with other entities. For example, Stewart's gave $50,000 and they made it out to the Friends of the Library, the check. And the Alfred E. Solomon organization gave $100,000 and that can be given to any not-for-profit, so which is the Friends. So you need these two entities. And basically the way this is going to work is that the money so far that the Friends has, a lot of it, and Laurie said to date, it's about $272,000 that has been collected, although some of that has run out. Whereas as of the last meeting of the Friends, at the end of September, we had $238,000 because we had paid, you know, Butler, Brown, and Mays for their services, for the architectural services, so we're paying that. And basically what's going to happen with the money from the Friends is that it's going to be the matching funds that are going to be required to match the DLD grant. And that's the way this is going to go forward. So I think it's important just so that we understand, you know, why we need both. It has been, we've been incredibly lucky. We've been, the former board and the current board has been very supportive of the work that the Friends have done. We have gotten, as I said, $50,000 from Stewart's. We got $25,000 from the Ballston Spa National Bank. The Lions have made an annual contribution. The Ryder Foundation, we did a donation drive starting in December of 22, and we got a tremendous outpouring from the public. So we have been incredibly lucky in terms of that. We found out that all of the entities and a lot of what we did, we went to, the Friends went to, I guess last year, a lot of the farmers markets and any place we could, not just to collect money. We have this donation duck, and people just put money in and give us donations, and it all goes to the capital campaign. The only money that the Friends actually gets is from membership dues, which are very low. And that's what we use, along with contribution from Friends members, to run our, you know, if we have food at events, that comes from the membership dues or the operational funds. And we have $2,500. But then everything else, by action of the board of the Friends of the Library, everything else that we have collected or in any way since 2022 has gone to this capital campaign. So we have been very lucky in the support that we've had. And I just also want to say, aside from we run, what the Friends does is, in support of the library, we ran an auction, as Laurie said. We've been at the farmers markets. We've done trivia nights, that kind of thing. We are going to be, please mark it on your calendar, on October 13th, we are going to be at the Way We Work car show. We're going to have some raffles. We're going to have a book sale. And the raffle, we have a donation of a Way We Were car show jacket from Carol Beals in memory of her husband, Dave Beals, who many of you know, who was on the library board for years. So we're you know, doing things like that, and people have been incredibly generous. The other thing that the Friends does, have to call this out, I know this doesn't look like much. I cannot tell you that there were a dozen people who must have worked at least 100 hours to get this to where we had to empty out the room over there. We had to discard a lot of things. Nothing of importance. It's always better. I'm always more impressed with the Village of Ballston Spa. It's always better to have more and get rid of it than throw everything out and throw the wrong things out. But that is the kind of things that the Friends does. That was a multi-day, multi-hour, multi-person effort. And then we have combined, we've put all of this in within the blue tape so that the that this room is going to be the staging area where they're going to, where the workmen are going to keep their all their tools and work on the extension. So I have to say that personally, I have found this to be one of the most satisfying experiences of my life working with this group of people. This is a nonpartisan, smart, very committed group of people. It has been a lot of fun. It's been a little hectic and a little stressful sometimes, but it has been a lot of fun. And we have been very lucky, as I said, with the two boards, this board and the former board that has been supportive. But I just want to, you know, this is a group of neighbors and friends, not friends in the library, but neighbors and people who have gotten together, individuals who have volunteered their time. And this has been, you just have to know, this has been hundreds of hours over the last, since 2021. And I just want to mention in particular, Andy Mannion, Lori, AC, Patty Tess, Jason Buchek, and Jim Carter, who are on the library board, and also Kathy Gibson, Kristen Hyman, and Andrew Simmons, the library director, along with Lori and Andy, who are on the library board, their grants committee, also the Friends, which is Dan, the Friends board, which is Daniel Carter, Shelley Fenton, Meredith Tower, Mandy Ryder, Pat Burnham, Stan Lockwood, and myself. And also, you know, as I said, the library staff has been very, very cooperative. It is, we have gotten as far as Lori says, it is multi-year, multi-phase. We have more to do, but I have every confidence that between this, I guess it's a public-private partnership, we'll be able to get it done. And it really is absolutely amazing, and I think we all have to give ourselves credit for this, that we have come this far, basically since, well, in terms of the fundraising, since 22 and before, when the library board had the wisdom to decide that they needed a master plan and bring it forward and bring it to completion, and with the help of Butler Rowan Mace. So thank you very much. I hope that gives you an idea of the interaction between these two entities. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Quick couple points just for those wondering. Ultimately, the village is going to be the contracting party with the bidders for the work to be done. There will be a contract that Carl is working on between Friends and the village with respect to the money that Friends is holding, to basically say how the payment will work and everything else, so that we're meeting the grant rules, et cetera. And just something that I learned this week, I was talking to Assemblywoman Walsh, and she told me this was the largest library grant that she was able to announce for her district, the 112th district. We broke records here, Lori, and great job by the board and by Friends and everybody else on that. So congratulations on that. And we'll have some motions coming up. Before we get there, though, we'll have public comment on actually any questions, I should say, from the board before I skip ahead here. Sorry about that.
I just want to acknowledge the tremendous amount of work that has gone into this very important essential asset for the community, and I just want to thank you for that. And I'm very excited to see the plans, and you're making such a great contribution, so we all really appreciate it and look forward to great things. Thank you.
Anybody else? Hearing none. One note here, I'm going a little prompt to, and I'm gonna look to Sean on this, because it takes me a task on these things. We had to do some further research Friday after we put out the agenda with respect to the pickup truck that's on the agenda for EPW Water. There's an option to do four payments, I think, of $18,000 each, which would be about $72,000 over the lifetime. We had budgeted, I think it was $20,000 for pickup truck payment this year. When we looked at the plus minus of everything, we're leaning toward the $65,000, at least on the office side, the DPW side of it, to go one shot. But we also still have the option to go for the, lease to own financing approach, essentially. Mm-hmm. Which would you prefer? Because I am ambivalent, and I never got a chance to really reach out to everybody on that.
I mean, the last time it was pretty much a wash.
Just about. The interest rate this time seems a little bit higher because it's in the sevens. Mm-hmm. But, you know, over 4 years, ends up around $7,000, $8,000 more with interest. So
I mean, I'm always like, it's not going to leave us financially strapped to pay it in one shot. Obviously, then you don't have to worry about financing or anything.
So but we'll leave it as it sits then, if everybody's okay with that, then.
Yeah, I was wondering if that was in the budget or not. I guess $20,000 is in the budget.
$20,000 is in the budget. The amount for one-shot payment is $65,000 plus any tag title, et cetera, that goes off. But
so the rest will come out of general fund balance.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was kind of a coin flip at that point when I'm looking at the numbers. And I originally thought it was five payments. That was a no-brainer. And then we look back and it's like, no, it's four. And that makes sense math-wise, actually. So that's
it. And in terms of the cost, it's a government cost, right?
It's a state contract.
State contract. So we don't go out of the
correct. That's it's state contract documentation listed on the basically attachments that we have. Okay. Sorry to put everybody through that real quick, but I did want to make sure that we're all there, so I don't have to say we have a different motion coming up. So as it sits, is how we'll go forward. So this is public comment on agenda items only, 3 minutes per speaker. If you're on Zoom and you would like to speak about an agenda item, this would be the time to raise your hand. Is there anybody in the building here that would like to speak on an agenda item? Seeing none, seeing no hands, let's move forward. No consent agenda again tonight. Let's go to the motion we were just talking about. Take a motion approving the purchase of a 2024 Chevrolet Silverado 2500 HD from Mangino Chevrolet for the Department of Public Works Water Division for $65,000 based on the attached quote derived from the state contract pricing and authorizing the mayor to execute any necessary documentation related to the purchase.
I'll make the motion.
You're faster on that thing. Trustee Mendoza.
I'll second.
Trustee Price Bush, discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Now I got to paste the vote. I keep forgetting that.
I'm sorry. I'm trying.
No, that's my fault. Got to get a motion that the Village of Ballston Spa proclaims that April 26, 2024 was Arbor Day in the Village of Ballston Spa and urges all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day this year and every year.
I'll make the motion.
Trustee Baskin.
I'll second.
Trustee Mundane said discussion.
So this is required for the Tree City designation and it's under, right?
We did everything. We naturally do all of the other requirements. We just skipped the proclamation.
Right. Okay.
So we're proclaiming all right. Today.
And you caught it. So thanks for catching that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. I'll get it right before we're done with these. Can I get a motion to award the Ballston Spa Public Library Reading Room Edition Contract Number 1? General construction to bunk off general construction in the amount of $440,000. $425,000 is the base bid amount, plus add alternate one in the amount of $22,350.
I'll make the motion.
Oh, hold on for a second because actually the math on that is off. Lori, do you have the right number on that handy? So I'm just doing the quick addition in my head. That would be $447,350. I think that's.
No, I might have to look it up and. You have to know it right now because I couldn't find it.
Let me skip C. I'll go to D. Can I get a motion to award the Ballston Spa Public Library Reading Room Edition Contract Number 2, mechanical work to Mazone Plumbing and Heating in the amount of $57,081 as the lowest responsible bidder based on a thorough review and vetting of the bid submitted by all parties and upon a recommendation of Butler Rowland Mays Architects, LLP, Architect Engineer, Bid Processing Consultant for this project.
I'll make the motion.
I'm going to give it to Trustee Price Bush. I'll give the second to Trustee Fondanza. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Can I get a motion to
say aye?
Yeah, that's true. Can I get a motion to award the Ballston Spa Public Library Reading Room Edition Contract Number 3, Electrical Work to Allegiant Electric LLC of Kinderhook. In the amount of $70,197. $68,945 is the base bid amount plus alternate one in the amount of $1,252 as the lowest responsible bidder based on thorough review and vetting of the bid submitted by all parties and upon recommendation of Butler Rowland Mays Architects LLP, architect engineer bid processing consultant for this project.
I'll make the motion.
Trustee Baskin.
Second.
Trustee Raymond, discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. I'll keep rolling to F and we'll go back to C in a bit. Can I get a motion approving membership of the Village of Ballston Spa with the Saratoga Economic Development Corporation for a $500 supporter level and authorizing the mayor to execute required related documents for the membership?
Make that motion.
Trustee Fondanza will give a second to discussion.
Can you just talk about what benefits we get for our membership?
Yeah, SEDC will work with us in giving consultation and different guidance on economic development possibilities for the Village of Ballston Spa. They are happy to work with the SBPA on some of their needs as well. And so it's starting a relationship, I think actually restarting a relationship with the SEDC after Prosperity Partnership had gone defunct a few years ago. This is the only economic development arm really in Saratoga County right now. How's that for a good spiel? all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Can I get a motion deeming the October 15, 2024 meeting of the Board of Trustees as a special meeting for the purpose of determining Brownfield Opportunity Area Steering Committee members and any other time-sensitive business that comes up between the October 7, 2024 and October 15, 2024 meetings. The meeting will be held at 66 Front Street at 6:30 p.m.
I'll make that motion.
Trustee Price Bush.
I'll second.
Trustee Fondanza, discussion.
I'm just concerned that we won't have enough time to then attend the Zoning Advisory Committee meeting, which is half an hour later that same night. Is there a rush or could we wait till the regular meeting of the board the following week?
Up to you. Ultimately, I feel that we're kind of at that point. Bert, I want you to take this one since it's more under your guidance, sir.
I think at this point, if honestly, I can't imagine that we're going to have that much business. I know a lot of some of the applicants that have put their names in are curious to get going and then have asked me when we are going to appoint folks and as well as our consultants. So if we can just spend a little time doing that. I also want to get to that the ZAC meeting, that the public meeting they're having. So maybe we can make a real concerted effort to just kind of stay very focused.
Well, how many applications have we received?
Jen or Terry might be able to answer that because they've been holding them.
15? Or how many?
Nine was the maximum.
So there's six extra. We could easily spend half an hour figuring out nine out of 15.
Is that something we can do?
We can do it by email.
Yeah.
I mean, your thoughts and everything by email through next week. Tomorrow, she'll be getting those out after she puts the meeting up, I'm sure, on Zoom or on YouTube. So we'll have plenty of time to go amongst ourselves and then just hammer out any final questions or thoughts on Monday night, 6:30.
All right, so tomorrow we'll get all the applications.
Yep.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
I mean, that's like a regular, this is, today is sort of a special meeting, right? Because it's not the second Monday of the month.
We are deeming it as the regular meeting because we went to the full mode of it, and we're going to deem the 15th as a special meeting. So it's going to be kind of a more targeted meeting for that issue. And for instance, we got a late notice about the Thanksgiving dinner, the community dinner at Union Firehouse. We'll approve that on Monday instead of just rushing that through tonight. Although Mary will tell us more about that, I think, in her liaison report coming up. I see what happened, actually, Lori. So we'll get to that in a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Yep, the meeting, G. All in favor, G. Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, so what happened here is Paul had mixed in one party's contract piece bid and another's alternate number one. bunk off, their bid was $425,000 with an ad alternate of $15,000. So the total was actually correct. It was just the components were misreported in the letter that we received from Paul. So at this point, I think I can dump this now into kind of get a motion to award the Ballston Spa Public Library Reading Room Addition Contract Number 1, General Construction, to Bunk Off General Construction in the amount of $440,000. $425,000 is the base bid amount, plus add alternate one in the amount of $15,000 as the lowest responsible bidder based on a thorough review and vetting of the bids submitted by all parties and upon recommendation of Butler Rowland Mays Architects, LLP, architect, engineer, bid processing consultant for this project.
Make the motion.
Trustee Fidanza, Trustee Baskin, discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Here's announcements. I'll keep this brief. Thanks again to DPW for a great work they did on Prospect Street and Forest Park up in the fairground zone up there. Great work done and Evolution Paving again, thanks to them and our municipal partners that assist us all the time. There were some hiccups, but they still got it done by 6 o'clock on Thursday, I think it was, give or take. They worked their butts off to get that done to make sure they didn't carry over to Friday in any way, shape, or form possible. They did. We got some more paving coming up soon. I'll let Sean tell a little bit about that, but the general
you might as well keep going because I'm having some email difficulties.
The general location is the Mechanic Street zone with Van Buren and Ford Street up to Route 50 included on that list as well. So just make sure I'm not missing anything on that. Prepare for phase three paving, Maple Ave, Mechanic Street, possibly three others. Those two we just named are two of those others on there. So Kent Street, maybe a piece of it as well. I think it's the third, if my memory serves, but they're just working on their budget numbers to make sure that they've got enough to reach that much. But great work, and thanks again for everybody's patience with that project. I know it can be a pain. We get the calls, we get the emails, the Facebook messages and everything else. We get it, but it's once every 10 years if done right. We did have another individual apparently that decided to race down the barricaded streets in the Forest Park area, and while workers were present, and I just have to remind people how boneheaded that is, and actually driving somebody's yard, literally in their yard in the process of this. That is completely wrong. It is completely against the whole idea of trying to make sure that the blacktop cures so that we don't have to do it again in 5 years, ultimately spend the money and give the inconvenience a second time. It's 1 to 2 days maximum every 10 years that we ask people to sacrifice a little bit or to work with us. Emergency services are always going to get to whoever they need to get to. If it comes down to it, we work with them to let them know what's going on, the school district and everything else. So please, when you see the barricade, don't take it upon yourself to just run through it, and especially when you don't know if there's somebody in there that's not following traffic laws because they're working on the road in some way, shape, or form or another. It is completely dangerous and unfortunate when that happens. But now that it's the second time in two projects that we have information that somebody has gone through the road in that manner while it's being worked on, that's not right. Treasurer's report, quickly here, I just gotta go back up to this page. Okay, it's re-levy season. I mean, you know, how festive can you get for re-levy season? But our utilities are being re-levied to the town of Ballston, Milton, and Balta. We are working with the city of Saratoga Springs on, you know, determining a process to get re-levies to them because by law, we can't just automatically re-levy a city in the same manner. However, Mayor Safford and Mayor Kiernan showed an interest in working with us because we do have one very delinquent person. Shutting off water is not something that the Department of Health really smiles at as an option for us. So we're working on the idea of how to approach the city of Saratoga Springs situation like that. Tax re-levies will be sent toward the end of October or 1st of November. Bank reconciliations were sent today, I noticed. Work is being done on the AFR, expected to be completed this month. Planning to meet with Bob Fox this week, I think it is now, regarding some items that need to be clarified. Just a note here, and I believe the next regular meeting of our board will have Melissa, our treasurer here. LGSS is not supporting village and payroll processing beginning in 2025, as we've discussed when we approved their contract. We are working on getting proposals for a new payroll system that will need to be in place for 2025. More details to follow at that next board meeting, the next regular board meeting on October 28th. So Melissa will also give us some just general updates on the treasurer's department as a part of her presentation discussion on that. That's all I got. Let us start with somebody who's far, far away. Liaison report.
Just a couple things about the BSBPA. I want to commend them for having an amazing farmers market season this year. They just closed on Saturday with a little bit of celebration, honoring the farmers and the vendors, and also the chair, the committee chairs. We had Steve and Diana and Darvin who took that on, and they did a great job. And I just want to commend them for that. Our farmers market is really important to people that rely on walking. We have some seniors that had remarked to us that that's important to them, so that they can access fresh food instead of walking all the way to Hanford or all these. So just want to commend them. The vendors were up, the attendance was up. A lot of good work all around. And then also, just as a reminder, Christine Fitzpatrick said it earlier, the farmer's market, the car show is on October 7th. No, gosh, I almost said August. October. Oh my gosh. October 13th, which is Sunday. It's coming up. It's from 9 to 4. Just folks can be mindful of the parking restrictions. We don't want your car to have to be removed for that day, but it's always a great time. There's always a lot of folks there already. They exceeded their initial pre-registration. They usually cap it at 200. It's already over 200. And, you know, depending on what the weather is, they'll have a lot of folks come that day of and register that day for the show. So come down, spend your money, support our small businesses, and I'm just really thankful for all the work that they do. Thanks.
And lots and lots of money. Okay. Trustee Raymond. Actually, I'm going to help you out on this.
Oh, thank you.
You got it.
All right. So we're working the phase two paving, as the mayor stated. They're doing the prep for the car show. And they're also installing a new stop sign at the intersection of Saratoga Ave. I think they already did that, didn't they?
Saratoga Ave, no, not yet.
Yep.
Make sure your microphone on near you too. Oh, sorry. You are being picked up by the other one there, but just in case.
Okay. And then let's see, we had EPA lead service report has got to be done by this Friday. And then they're preparing for phase three paving. And they're going to continue interviewing candidates for two open positions. So one other thing I'd like to add when we were discussing the paving and work zone traffic control, I know the state, and I'm sure there's laws on the books, that if you drive through a barricade or move a barricade and you damage new road, there is a what is called an accident damage recovery program, and I know the state does it, and I don't know the specifics whether a municipality can hop on.
I tried to look at a village version of it. I didn't find one on a quick fly of it last week when I found out about it.
So in theory, an individual would be responsible for the repairs of that pavement. I don't know if you know, paving costs a lot of money. So in addition, you know, not the, you know, the equipment or material part of it, as the mayor said, it's, you know, you're violating the work zone, which New York State has gotten very stiff about violating work zones. So I would urge anyone who thinks that, oh, well, I'm only going to just do this for a minute, don't. Because the ramifications could be bad for you, and it could also be bad for someone who's not, because a road is closed, isn't paying attention because they don't expect our oncoming traffic. I just wanted to add that.
No, I appreciate that, and I'm fully with you on that one. I just thinking of, you know, if somebody's speeding through a street like that on somebody's yard and whatnot, they're not going to see a person standing in that work zone that's a worker or anybody else for that matter that would not anticipate it. And there's got to be at least a common law approach to take legally, if not an actual law in the books, for reclaiming that in that scenario if they did do damage. So great point. Thank you very much for that. Mary.
A reminder that the library pumpkin contest is ongoing, and literary themed pumpkins can be dropped off October 15th and 16th at the library. And no carved pumpkins, please.
Don't carve your pumpkins.
Not for this. As Mayor Rossi had mentioned, the community Thanksgiving dinner is coming up, and we're looking for new members who are interested, new volunteers, old volunteers. And if you want to contact Sean Mulvaney, you can reach him or Jody on Facebook through the Thanksgiving community Facebook page. They're going to be preparing Wednesday night, November 27th, and then serving on Thursday, November 28th.
That's the latest Thanksgiving can be, actually. Wow. Is.
And again, if people don't know, the meals are free of charge. So if you're not doing anything Thanksgiving, stop in at Union Firehouse.
Appreciate any donations people give sometimes, but if you can't afford a donation, you don't have to worry about that.
And the Ballston area seniors, if no one has checked them out yet, they are coming up with their 2025 memberships. If you haven't looked at their activity list, they have dinners, dances, trips, community activities, and their memberships range from $15 to $0, depending on your age. And you can contact Barb Broderson, and her phone number is listed on their website if you have any questions about the membership.
Great.
And that's it.
Awesome. Thank you. Ben.
The Park and Tree Board has been working on a number of things. They are working on the first phases of improvements in Griswold Park in terms of trying to firm up what products might go in that park. They've been also consulting people on their trees, and they're also working on grass signage for the parks in terms of park rules. With Arbor Day being mentioned, the agenda of the Park and Tree Board wants to encourage anyone who is interested in planting trees to reach out to them for the proper steps to take and what trees to plant, what are appropriate and where. Their next meeting is at 7 p.m. on Tuesday, October 15th at Cornell Cooperative Conference Room. The Committee on the Arts has a lot of things going on. Upcoming is Make and Take Saturdays, 12 to 3 p.m. Brookside Museum on October 26th, Create with Collage. November 2nd, Printmaking Cards. And November 9th, Alcohol Ink Tiles. So look them up on Facebook, Ballston Committee on the Arts, and you can register. You need to register ahead of time, but it is free Saturdays, 12 to 3. The committee's next meeting is October 16th at the Real McCoy. They do mention that they still need a permanent meeting space identified, that they cannot use the library. And also, very importantly, the Saratoga Arts re-grant season is now open. So anyone who has any interest in a grant of up to $5,000, they should reach out to the Committee on Arts as soon as possible. They can provide guidance and support on applications. And they need to be completed by November 2nd so that the village can consider November 12th. Did you just forward me something else?
I did, actually. I'll explain what it is. Okay. I meant to do this late last week, and I end up doing it right now because it just occurred to me. Caitlin and Chris Williams and I had done a walkthrough of the trees. They talked a little bit about this on Route 50, Milton Avenue specifically. The one that was in front of 199 Milton Ave basically got Dutch elm disease. And so Chris had gone down to look at that one, and it's been removed. We'll get de-stumped and de-rooted to the degree we can soon. But in the process, Chris looked at the other ash trees that are lining both sides of the road. And as I said at the last meeting, there's a shelf life right now of less than 2 years for probably the survival of most of those trees. And so Chris kind of spotted approach with respect to those in an email to Caitlin and me. And I shared it just now to the board, so you can begin reviewing it as well. Also for the trees that are on both sides, but mainly on the west side of Milton Avenue that are even the sidewalk. That's where the worst of it is, although there are some activity like that on the east side of the street. And how to handle that, what to do in terms of removal, handling sidewalk, replanting, et cetera. So beginning stages of trying to scope out a plan once and for all here to remedy one of the most complained about scenarios that we hear about, which is the tree issues on Milton Ave, the heave on the sidewalk, and the like. So take a good look at that. It'll be good information. And thanks to Chris, because he went in depth on this as well in some great ways to get us the information. I have not actually gotten to read the whole thing because it goes a little in the weeds, no pun intended, but it's in a good way, not in a bad way. It's something we should all absorb reading it. Okay, we have no old business listed, no new business listed. Public comment on any issue, 3 minutes. And I see your hand, Marilyn, already. So give me 1 second just to remind folks that you can come up in the meantime. If you want to speak on Zoom, now's a good time to raise your hand on Zoom. It'll be, again, 3 minutes on any issue. And normal rules apply, respect, and address the board. That's just the general reminders. Is Marilyn has come up here with a sign, and I know that sign, Marilyn.
Yeah. Go ahead. Marilyn Stevenson, 45 West High Street. I'm holding a sign that you're probably, hopefully, have seen. Friday, Peter Martin and I put them up. They're a reminder to the village to attend the public rezoning workshop, which will be October 15th from 7 to 9 p.m. at 50 West High Street. The Zoning Advisory Committee has a consultant, Fisher, from Fisher and Associates out in Western New York, and he's going to conduct a project overview for our rezoning activities. He's got a 36-slide PowerPoint that he's going to give very quickly about zoning. And then he's going to do basically what he calls an open house style format to engage the community about zoning topics that the Zoning Advisory Committee has been talking about in small groups for the last 11 months. So I would encourage everyone who's listening in, either live or after the meeting is over, to please ask your friends and neighbors to attend this. We have not done an update to zoning for more than 30 plus years. And this is your opportunity to get in on the ground floor to talk about more modern zoning issues. I'd encourage you to spread the word. We've done so by social media, through print media, and through the outreach of the signs. I want to thank Peter Martin for helping me last Friday to get the 20 signs out. I also want to thank Jared Icolucci for developing the flyer, which you may or may not see around town at certain businesses. And also to Margaret Danison, and Darvin Bowie, both helped with some aspects of the media outreach, as well as Darvin helping with BSBPA outreach. And to Matt Erkeline, who is the chairman of the Zoning Advisory Committee, and all the committee members for their work over the last 11 months. So we need to get the word out. It is a workshop, which means we are going to ask you to do a little bit of work. And, you know, if you wouldn't mind, just, we've had some challenges with the sign. I know some of the signs we put out on Friday have started to walk away. So if you see a sign and then you don't see it in the next couple of days, please let us know. I know one's already been removed and I removed this tonight, but I will replace it. Okay, if you have any questions, feel free to ask Jen or anybody on the Zoning Advisory Committee. Jen's been very helpful with the design of the sign. We're appreciative. It's very attractive. And maybe that's why people are moving them around.
They're so pretty.
Okay, thank you.
Listen, that's my pick of purple. I'm going to take credit for the purple. Thank you. Just one minor correction. Actually, there has been zoning changes in the last 30 years, but that's why our zoning is so bad, because what happens is it becomes a hodgepodge, a patchwork of zoning laws that don't necessarily take each other into account. And you end up with anomalies all over the place and things that just... it becomes nightmarish when you try to apply it. And our planning board or zoning board can tell you a lot more about that because they're obligated to handle a lot of that stuff. And so this is an opportunity to make sure it actually flows together again after years and years and years of not ultimately. So thank you, Marilyn, for that. Anybody else in the room? Actually, see a hand on. Let's go with the hand.
That's Keith.
Mr. Lewis.
He's still muted.
Keith Lewis, 35th Street, New York. On September 12th, 2022, the Village Board approved a contract with LUMAC, which has a termination date of December 31st, 2024. An exact copy of the contract was presented to the board, along with a cover letter from LUMAC, in which they stated, and I quote, based on current markets and the village's desire to transfer ownership of the parcel to the town of Milton. I remind the board of this fact because the contract that Frank signed on November 21st, 2022, has a termination date of August 30th, 2023. This change was not discussed publicly, and the public was not given the opportunity to voice any concerns. No doubt such concerns would have arisen as this change compromised the village's position and no further equity was offered by LUMAC for that compromise. It reduced the term by 1 year and 4 months. Throughout most of my career, I've negotiated contracts for a living, changing the term by 16 months with LUMAC, especially when the village was in discussions with Milton regarding property ownership, is without a doubt a material change. Milton purchased the property for $435,000. No municipality can pay more than the appraised value for the property, so it's clear that this was an appropriate valuation. I reviewed the LUMAC contract and there is no buyout clause. More importantly, that contract is not valid because it was not signed with board approval. I understand that Frank has discussed paying LUMAC $75,000, which is the full amount they projected they would make if the lumber was harvested and they performed the work. However, they did not complete the work. They only marked trees. Perhaps the board should discuss an equitable fee for LUMAC, but the mayor should not be involved in those discussions, as this matter appears to fall under the village's errors and omissions insurance. Arbitrarily awarding taxpayer money would not be wise. I hope that when this is discussed, it will receive a thoughtful examination, unlike the discussion earlier this summer, where Trustee Price Bush was asked her legal opinion, despite being in the room with a Harvard Law graduate and our village attorney, and allowed to give misinformation to be presented as fact, information that anyone with a smartphone could have easily verified as untrue. The money this board spends belongs to the taxpayers, and we expect you to take your duties.
Well, the only 6 seconds left anyway.
Well, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else in the room? Okay. Seeing none?
Wait, form of vote. Oh, no. Mm-hmm. Foreman raised his hand. Oh, there he has it. Now Foreman is raising his hand.
Okay.
No, hold on. Now he's not raising his hand.
Now I got Caitlin
up there. Well, shoot.
Okay, Foreman, don't touch your computer for a second.
No.
No. Okay, well.
Maybe ask him to put it in the chat if he actually needs to.
I think we disable chat.
Oh, okay.
I can't keep him there long enough.
Foreman, stop raising your hand if you hear me. Just leave it where it is right now. Go ahead. Okay. Foreman, if you want to talk, unmute now. Okay, go ahead.
Hello? Can you hear
me? Yes.
Hey, this is Zlata Phillips speaking from 201 Hyde Boulevard.
Go ahead.
Love your neighbor. Oh, what happened on Sunday, 29th of September, can really prove that there are still some good neighbors in the village. Night before, somebody knocked down all the posters and senior citizen sign from our lawn, but we didn't do anything then, waiting for Sunday. And on Sunday morning, neighbors to the south, young family with two small children volunteered to pick up those posters and signs and put them back where they were. In meantime, a stranger parked his car on our lawn and was holding cup of coffee in his hands behind the tall grasses and the poodle barking a little bit and then relieving itself, so we couldn't even see well his face. But good neighbors, mother and father of young children succeeded in convincing the stranger to remove, first of all, his car from our lawn and just leave the area. Then that was first thank you. Second thank you for somebody we don't know about anything who brought four fence posts, tall fence posts, maybe meter and a half tall, and put them where those lower posters were on the edge of the property. So many thanks to that person. One of those posters was already bent a little bit. And last but not least, next day, when property owned by on the north dumped some stuff on our driveway when they were cleaning, somebody told them to pick it up and we could normally drive on our driveway. So sometimes some very ugly things are happening, but it's so nice to have good neighbors, and many thanks to all those people, known and unknown, who helped us. That's all I have to say. Thank you, Mayor Rossi, and all members of the Village of Ballston Spa Board, all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for sharing that very nice thought about our Village of Friends. Anybody else? Seeing none, it is time for other business, including but not limited to board response to public comment. Go ahead.
I've always wondered, is there a reason why that date was changed?
It was discussed in this meeting twice, so go back to the archives on that one if you want. Also, just to address the thing about the termination fee situation, if you remember correctly, Milton had to negotiate that with Lou Mack ultimately, so the information that Mr. Lewis provided was erroneous here in his discussion. But beyond that.
I don't remember... an answer in the archives, is there,
yeah,
is
Carla,
there something you could share?
Carla answered it, that the contract she recommended me sign was the one I signed. So that's what I do.
So she changed the date or you changed the date?
I didn't change anything. I put my signature on the agreement I'm told to sign ultimately.
So you're saying Carla changed the date?
I don't know if she changed the date. She gave me that as a version to sign. So not sure what that is.
I can look into it if it's okay. A question that you have.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. Bernadette, you're all good?
I'm good. Thanks.
No problem. Can I get a motion that the vouchers be audited and the meeting adjourned at 8:14 p.m.?
I'll make that motion.
Trustee Price Bush, okay. Trustee Baskin, discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We'll see folks on the 15th at 6:30 or the 28th at 7 o'clock. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, Brenda.
Oh, except for Ben says that. And there you go.
You would be a copy for that. You would then create application.